possess every and all living beings. We stand the wonderful Dharma will to teach us how to be suffering and attain bliss and end birth and death and quickly realize nothing.
Namo Sadanto Suche Doye Alaihati Sammyao Sambutoshe.
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 Namo Sadanto Suche Doye Alaihati Sammyao Sambutoshe. Namo Da Phang Guang Pho Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Hui Pho Phu Sa.
Namo Da Phang Guang Pho Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Hui Pho Phu Sa.
Namo Da Phang Guang Pho Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Hui Pho Phu Sa.
Namo Da Phang Guang Pho Hua Yen Jing Hua Yen Hai Hui Pho Phu Sa.
Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expanded Teachings. Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of Great Expanded Teachings and the Ocean Wide Flower Garland Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas.
Wu Sang Sen Sen Wei Miao Fa Bai Qian Wan Jie Nan Zao Yu Wo Jing Jian Wen De Shou Chu Yuan Jie Ru Lai Zhen Shi Yi.
The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom thus come one's true and actual meaning.
玄公上人，各位法师，各位佛友，大家阿弥陀佛。今天是2015年3月7日，星期六的晚上。 现在是在加州伯克莱盛世，我们要一起来研究《大方广佛华严经》。现在我们在华严经这个十地品的第六地，叫做现前地。
Hey, all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, Venerable Masters, Dharma Masters, and Dharma Friends, good evening. Tonight is March 7th, 2015, and we're here in Berkeley Buddhist Monastery lecturing on the Avatamsaka Sutra. We're right now in the chapter called the Ten Grounds chapter, and in the Ten Grounds, we're in the section that's describing the Sixth Ground Bodhisattva. And this Sixth Ground Bodhisattva's ground is actually called the Ground of Manifestation.
为什么叫做现前地呢？这个可以表示呢，菩萨他的善根成熟了，他很多这个好的都现前了，像他的智慧现前了，他的神通现前了，他的慈悲现前了。那么这个都是菩萨在修行过程中，因为呢他修种种善的法门，所以呢就得到一个善果。 这些善果呢是不求自得的，就是你在修行呢，你只要没有执着，那么你一直修行修到这个第五地以后呢，那修行第六地的法门，那么菩萨呢他就可以得到种种的这些像慈悲啊、智慧啊，或是辩才神通，就会自然而然的现前了。因此呢，如果我们学习佛法，那么你每天呢好好的修行，或是像现在有讲经的法会。 你能够在忙里偷闲到这个道上来听法，这个听法呢可以开智慧，因为本来每个人都有智慧，但是呢，我们迷了，所以就不知道说我们自信就是一个宝藏，就是一个最有智慧的这种大宝藏。那我们一直在外面找这个智慧，其实外面呢，一般来讲都不是叫做智慧，外求的都是一种叫做聪明才智，或是呢，四智变聪。 世间的智慧或是一种聪明。那么世间智跟这些聪明呢，在佛教来讲，它不是真正的智慧，而且是一种难，一种障难。什么难呢？因为人呢太聪明了，往往呢对真理就不能相信，他会用自己的这种世心分别啊，或是去思量种种这种道理。那么因此呢，对佛法有时候他就不相信，甚至毁谤。因此呢，这个真正的智慧呢是内求的，不是外求。所谓内求呢，是在我们的自信上好好的去参究我们的自信是什么。那么外求就是你在追逐外面的这些啊知识、学识、常识所得来的。那可是这个是永远呢都是追求不完，甚至呢是啊永无止境的，甚至让人呢一直在不断的重复学习。比如说我们在六道中不断的轮回，那这辈子呢，你从小学开始读书，读到中学啊，读到大学啊，有些人上了研究所，拿了硕士、博士啊，做了很多学问，得了很多学位。那么，可是这一生完了呢，死了。死了以后呢，如果不明白这个佛法的话，那就是糊里糊涂呢，又去六道轮回了，因为你一轮回呢，自己也不晓得要升到哪一道去。那么即使呢再来做人，那么一做人呢，一样又出生，又从小学又开始很辛苦又读书啊，然后上了中学又读书，到大学读书，然后又继续又是硕士又是博士。那么你看呢、啊，以前过去生中读了很多啊，这辈子来了要再重新再读一次，又辛苦一次，然后呢又最后又死了，又去投胎。那么投胎如果好还又做人，你就永无止境的轮回。可是呢，如果我们学习佛法是完全不一样的，而学习佛法你这个智慧呢一点一滴，这个智慧打开了以后呢，那个智慧你呢就永远啊就不会再失了。就是说你得到这个智慧，那么今生呢你有智慧了，你来生在修行呢，智慧就更大，善根呢就更成熟。将来你成佛了以后，那这个智慧就是最究竟的。
So why is this ground called the ground of manifestation? This ground is called manifestation because this bodhisattva's good roots have matured. What good roots?Well, his good roots from cultivating goodness, his good roots from cultivating wisdom, from spiritual power, spiritual abilities, his great compassion, his expedient means, all these good roots, these kind of goodnesses, these good seeds, he's planted and they've matured, so they've manifested. So he cultivates many, many good Dharma doors and they have brought about good results.However, he cultivates all of these without any attachment. These good results are just naturally things that come from this cultivation. It's not something that he seeks outside to have some kind of result. They just come very naturally in one's cultivation. So everybody here, for instance, is coming to the sutra lecture and has taken time out of their busy schedule to come learn the Dharma. To be able to listen to the sutra lecture is a chance for you to open your wisdom, for you to develop your inherent wisdom.It's not something you gain from seeking outside. Because all of us have this, this inherent wisdom within us already. We have our self-nature, and our self-nature is actually a treasury. And it's the treasury of all this wisdom. But if we look for this wisdom outside, we try to go for externals to find wisdom, this external world outside, we'll never find it. And all that we learn outside is actually just, you could say, an intelligence.A kind of maybe even clever or an intelligence or being smart. All this kind of skills with the mind, this rational mind, is actually not the wisdom of Buddhism. And it's just a kind of an intelligence that one develops. And it can actually even become an obstacle in one's cultivation. Because if you have our mind is too intelligent,And then it actually becomes hard to believe in true principle because our mind's always discriminating, always critical, always analyzing. And it's hard for us to really be able to absorb the principles of the Dharma. And so if we look outside for knowledge and wisdom, we never find it. We can pick up knowledge, but this kind of understanding, this knowledge, is just ongoing. It never finishes, it never ends. And we just go on and on, over and over and over. So for instance, as a person who studies in the world, we might go to elementary school, and then we go to middle school, and then we go to high school. Then we go to college and get our bachelor's degree, and then we get a master's degree, then we get a PhD. And then we get all these different degrees, and then at some point we die. And if in this process we never really developed any wisdom and didn't really understand things deeply and didn't understand the Dharma, then we just go back on this cycle of rebirth, this cycle of death and rebirth. We're in samsara, and we just go on and on. And we come, maybe if we have cultivated good seeds, then we might come back as a person again. And we're back as a person, then again we go through the same process. We go to school, we go get a elementary school, we go to middle school, we go to high school, go to college, and so forth. And then again, this process we go through, all the hard work and suffering involved with going to school and learning all these things. And again, we die again. And then if we're fortunate and did good deeds, then we know we've come back as a person again. And we go through the same process again and again and again. And it just goes on and on and on. But if we want to actually learn the Dharma and develop our wisdom, what happens is actually completely different. When we develop our wisdom, it allows us in our life to be able to have a deeper understanding. And so when we die, we're not just lost. We can actually develop deeper and deeper understanding and our wisdom, so we don't just get lost in the cycle of birth and death. Then life after life, as we cultivate our wisdom slowly gets uncovered. Our goodness slowly develops. We cultivate this bit by bit.
在上个星期呢，我相信你们研究过十种心了。这个先前地的菩萨，他也修习了十种心以后呢，那么他可以继续来顺佛菩提。所以今天我们可以从这上个礼拜所研究过的那段经文，我们一起读一次，因为这样才会有印象。然后再接着就来开始研究今天我们所要研究的第六地现前地菩萨的修行。所以如果你有这个本子，那现在中文是在24页，英文就在第25页。我们读一下。
So last week we spoke about the 10 minds and of the Bodhisattva. And so now the next section about the 10 minds is actually how the 10 minds allows the Bodhisattva to go towards the Bodhi of the Buddha, the Buddha's Bodhi. So in terms of the book, we're on page 24, 25. I would ask maybe we recite the passage from last week, and then we'll read the next section that we're going to be lecturing on as well. That way will be a sense of continuity, so people know what we're referring to. So we're on bottom of page 24, last paragraph.
24页最后一段，请合掌。佛子，
佛子，
菩萨住此现前地，
菩萨住此现前地，
复更修习满足不可坏心，
复更修习满足不可坏心，
决定心，
决定心，
纯善心，
纯善心，
甚深心，
甚深心，
不退转心，
不退转心，
不修习心，
不修习心，
广大心，
广大心，
无边心，
无边心，
求智心，
求智心，
方便会相应心，
方便会应心心，
皆悉圆满，
皆悉圆满。
佛子，
佛子，
菩萨以此心顺佛菩提，
菩萨以此心顺佛菩提，
不惧议论，
不惧议论，
入诸智地，
入住之地，
离二乘道，
离二乘道，
去于佛智，
去于佛智，
诸烦恼魔无能取坏，
诸烦恼魔无能取坏，
住于菩萨智慧光明，
住于菩萨智慧光明，
于空无相，
于空无相，
无愿法中，
无愿法中，
皆善修习，
皆善修习，
方便智慧相恒共相应，
方便智慧恒共相应，
菩提奋法常行不舍，
菩提奋法常行不舍。
佛子，
佛子，
菩萨住此现前地中，
菩萨住此现前地中，
得般若波罗蜜恨增上，
得般若波罗蜜恨增上，
得第三名利顺忍，
第三名利顺忍，
已于诸法如实相随顺无为故，
已于诸法如实相随顺无为故。
好，英文。
So recite the English. We can read it together. In the bottom of page 25, last paragraph. Put their palms together. Disciples of the Buddha, when the Bodhisattva dwells on this, the ground of manifestation, he further increases his cultivation and perfection of an indestructible mind, a decisive mind, an entirely good mind, a deep, profound mind, a non-retreating mind, an unresting mind, a vast, great mind, a boundless mind, a mind of seeking wisdom, and a mind of interaction of expedience and wisdom, all of which are totally perfected. Disciples of the Buddha, the Bodhisattva uses those 10 minds to follow the Bodhi of a Buddha. He does not fear other theories. He enters the ground of all wisdom. He separates from the path of the two vehicles. He tends towards the wisdom of a Buddha. No demons of afflictions are able to destroy him. He dwells within the light of the wisdom of a Bodhisattva. He well cultivates within all the dharmas of emptiness, marklessness, and wishlessness. For him, wisdom and expedience are constantly interactive. He always cultivates the dharmas of the Bodhi sharers and does not forsake them. Disciples of the Buddha, when the Bodhisattva is dwelling on this, the ground of manifestation, he achieves increase of the practices of Prajnaparamita. He attains the third level of patience, that of clarity and keenness to accord. He accords with the real mark of true thusness of all dharmas and does not oppose it.
我们现在就在第二十六页的中文。那佛子，菩萨以此心顺佛菩提，不惧议论，入诸智地。在这里呢，因为现在是十地品，所以讲十地品是这个金刚藏菩萨，他是代替佛来讲这个十地品的。那么请法的人呢是金刚床菩萨，所以呢，现在金刚藏菩萨呢对着这个华严法会上的所有这些菩萨呢，就说呢，佛子，就是称呼菩萨的意思。菩萨以此心顺佛菩提。现在呢，这个第六地现前地的菩萨，他因为修行了前面讲的十种心，那么这个十种心他修行圆满了，所以呢，他用这个十种心呢顺佛菩提，就来随顺诸佛的菩提，就是佛呢，所有的佛是怎么？菩提就是觉，就是所有的佛是怎么觉的觉悟的，怎么觉悟成佛的。那么这个菩萨呢，就随顺着这个佛的菩提也来修行，不惧议论。他在修行过程中呢，不惧就是不害怕，没有恐惧，没有畏惧，任何部位都没有。那议论，议就是不同，论就是一种论说，就是他一点呢部位都没有，没有恐惧的，不怕这个外道邪说，或是这个异端，或是种种的这种不同的论说，入诸智地。那么这个菩萨呢，他就入了诸，就是代表很多智慧这种境界，地就是一种境界了。那么意思说，这个菩萨呢，他只要把这种十种心修行圆满了，这个时候呢，他就可以随顺的这个过去诸佛所修行的种种法门，怎么如何觉悟的。因为佛的菩提呢，是最究竟的一种菩提。我们一般讲这个菩提就是觉了。那觉呢，有三种。第一个就是自觉，觉他，这个声闻还有缘觉呢，他们是自觉自己觉悟了，但是呢，他不发心来觉悟其他的众生。那么菩萨呢是自觉觉他，那么可是呢，他这个觉呢还没有圆满，可是佛呢是三觉圆了，就是呢自觉觉他觉恨圆满了，他这种觉的修行恨门呢全部都圆满了，所以呢佛叫三觉圆万德备，那么他所有的德呢都具备了。那这个所以佛的修行，他这种菩提的恨门呢是最圆满最究竟的。这个第六地的菩萨 虽然离成佛呢还有一段距离，可是他因为修习了十种这个心，所以他现在啊就在修行的时候呢，就能够随顺到佛的菩提了。那么修行过程中呢，因为常常会有障碍的，比如说我们想发心修行了，那么也许呢，我们周边会有人来障碍我们，或是有些外道也会来障碍我们，或是有些修行人呢也会遇到这种天魔来障碍。可是呢，这个菩萨呢，这个时候不管是什么境界，他都无所恐惧了，一点害怕也没有。那么所有的邪说或是异端或是这些外道的论点，都不能动摇菩萨修行菩提的这个决心了。
So here in this section of the Bodhisattvas are speaking to one another. Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva is the one speaking, and the person who made the request, the Bodhisattva who made the request is Moon of Liberation Bodhisattva. And Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva is speaking this sutra for all those assembled in the Avatamsaka assembly. And so he's teaching all these various Bodhisattvas this Dharma. And so here, the Bodhisattva on the sixth ground is able to cultivate all these minds and perfect them so that he can use these minds to follow the Bodhi of a Buddha. Basically, the Bodhi of a Buddha is the Buddha's awakening. He's trying to follow the Buddha's awakening. That's the reason for his cultivation. And the first one, he says that he does not fear other theories. So the idea of fear, you could say he's not frightened at all. He's not scared at all. He's fearless towards everything. Nothing fears him. Nothing scares him. And he has this kind of attitude towards all theories. What kind of theories? You have various theories. For instance, there's literally from the Chinese, it's white Dao, is externalist teachings. Teachings, you could say, that's outside the nature, which seek outside. So all these kind of theories of our philosophies outside that don't lead us back to our nature, he has no fear of. He knows how to handle them. He's also able to enter the ground of all wisdom. And here, this is, you could say, that maybe a state where he's able to have various myriad wisdoms. He's able to cultivate all wisdom. And then he's cultivating all this in accord with the Buddha's Bodhi, the Buddha's awakening. This word awakening has oftentimes three meanings to it. There is an awakening of self, awakening of others, and perfection of awakening. And so the first one, it was a self-awakening, is referred to the sound-hearer disciples. They hear the Dharma and they cultivate themselves so that they can awaken themselves. But they do not have the heart to awaken all other living beings. So they are considered to have been able to awaken themselves. The second group, which is the Bodhisattvas, have awakened themselves and also awakened others. They're great Bodhisattvas. And so that's the second level. But still, they have not perfected their awakening of others and themselves, except for the Buddha, who is perfect in, they say, three awakenings. The first one is the awakening of others, the awakening of themselves, and also they have perfected to all the awakened practices. They've perfected all the various practices. So the Buddha has perfected these three things. And it's said that he is replete with the myriad virtues. So the Buddha is considered the most virtuous, has the most merit and virtue of all, because he's cultivated this over so long. So this Bodhisattva on the sixth ground still has some ways to becoming a Buddha, but he's on the path to becoming a Buddha. He's following the Buddha's Bodhi. And when we're cultivating on this path, oftentimes there's many obstructions in the way. We want to cultivate the way. Sometimes people come to obstruct us. Sometimes the external environment becomes a obstruction, a difficulty. Or for some cultivators, they can even have the demons come from the heavens to come and obstruct and try to disturb one's cultivation. But this Bodhisattva, however, he has no fear. He does not fear any theories coming from anybody about anything, because he's firm and clear in his mind. His mind does not move.
要能够不具议论的话，就必须呢具有辩才。因为呢，你在修行过程中，如果有人呢跟你意见不同了，或是呢他 持一种很特异的这种论点要跟你辩论的话，如果我们没有辩才，就没有办法跟人家辩论，或是呢会产生一种恐惧。所以呢，这个佛或是很多菩萨或是很多高僧大德，他们都具足了四无碍辩。这四无碍辩具足了以后呢，那么他就辩才无碍了。这个四无碍辩是叫做意无碍辩、持无碍辩、法无碍辩、乐说无碍辩，就是呢他在辩论的时候呢，对一个义理，他呢可以呢演说到无穷无尽的义理，或是呢从一个义理呢，他可以发挥到很多很多的义理。那么所有的义理呢，他都能够通达无碍了，或是呢能够圆融无碍的来演说，这个叫做义无碍辩，就是把经典或是呢一个世间法、出世间法的道理呢，他的道理都完全明白透彻了，这个叫做义无碍辩。持无碍辩，像我们在讲话的时候，常常呢会词不达意，比如说你讲话了，但是一下子找不到一个合适的词来形容、来表达，这个就是因为我们还没有到持无碍辩的这种境界。如果你有辩才了，那这个你在演说的时候呢，你这个演说的词句可以呢非常优美，同时呢在表达的时候很顺畅，就像行云流水般的，那这个你要用什么词句来表达你的意思都是很自在、很无碍的，这个就是一种持无碍辩。还有就是法无碍辩，因为佛法呢有84000种法门，我们一般来讲呢，你看这个在中国会讲到五大宗啊，五大宗呢就是像禅宗啊，或是教宗、律宗啊、密宗、净土宗。那每个宗派呢都有它不同的这种法门。那么这个一个有智慧、有四无碍辩的人呢，他在种种的法门在演说的时候，他就可以得到一种无碍的辩才了。就是说他随拿哪一个法门来演说，都可以呢这个没有任何障碍。这个就是表示他把这个所有的 佛法呢都通达无碍了，那么就得到法无碍辩。另外一个叫做乐说无碍辩，在演说的过程中或是辩论过程中呢，他都是很欢乐的，就是呢很愿意的来为众生演说佛法，那么没有疲厌。这个呢是很不容易的，因为一般人呢这个身心疲累的时候，他呢就大概也不想讲话了。可是一个得到四无碍辩的人呢，他不管怎么说，这不管怎么累，他呢还是很欢喜的来为众生呢演说佛法。因此呢，这个菩萨呢现在也表示呢，他已经呢能够得到四无碍辩了，所以呢他就可以不去议论啊，不会对任何的这种不同的这种论点，那么找这个菩萨来辩论的时候，他有所恐惧了。
So again, for the first one, that this bodhisattva does not fear other theories. This bodhisattva has, you could say, a great deal of eloquence. Eloquence is, you could say, skill in speech, knows how to use his words, knows how to speak. This is because if somebody comes and wants to debate the bodhisattva and has all these various theories or philosophies, you have to have eloquence to be able to talk to this person with skill. Otherwise, you don't know what to say, and then you could be afraid. So this bodhisattva actually has the four eloquences. They're kind of called the four fearless eloquences. He is able to bring them to perfection. What are the four fearless eloquences of four fearless eloquences or ways of speaking that are skillful? The first one is that of having an eloquence in meaning. The second is having an eloquence in phrasing. The third is an eloquence in the Dharma. The third is an eloquence that's associated with having a joy in speaking and teaching Dharma. So to explain it, the first one is the eloquence of meaning. This is that the Bodhisattva is able to understand the meaning of everything in a very penetrating way, regardless if it's world transcending or mundane dharma, mundane things. He looks at it and can see the meaning and the deeper the deeper meaning behind it. And he's able to take one meaning and connect it with limitless meanings and see all these various things and how they don't obstruct one another. So he's able to really penetrate the meaning. That's the first one, the first fearlessness. The second fearlessness is that of phrasing, of being able to use his words skillfully. So for all of us, I think we come to certain situations when we want to say something and then we can't find the words to express it. This bodhisattva does not have that problem at all. He knows exactly what words to use and how to say it to make it connect with the people he's trying to talk to. And he can say it in a very skillful, natural, spontaneous manner that just goes right to the heart of the person. So that's the second one, which is a eloquence in phrasing. The third one is an eloquence in the Dharma. So here, I believe we all know that there's often taught 84,000 different Dharma doors, different Dharma practices. And in China, what's developed has been the five schools of practice, the five schools of Buddhism. And so what are these? For instance, there's the Chan school, a Chan meditation. There's the Pure Land school. There's the Vinaya school, around discipline. There's the teaching school, which is the study of the scriptures. And then there's the esoteric school, which is mantras and so forth. And so these five different schools of practice are all understood very well by this bodhisattva, so that he's able to teach these methods as needed to the living beings expediently. But he also can teach them so that none of them actually obstruct one another. All the dharmas naturally work together. They can interpenetrate. He is able to penetrate into the deeper meaning behind all these different dharma practices. So this is how he's fearless in the dharma. The last one is a fearlessness in the joy of speaking. So in all situations, when this bodhisattva is speaking, he is very joyful. He's very happy. He's willing to teach. He doesn't get tired of it. He doesn't get weary of it. For instance, many of us, if we're tired, if our body is sick, or our mind is feeling fatigued, then we don't want to teach. We want to rest. But this bodhisattva is different. Even though he might be feeling fatigued, he's always happy to teach. And so he has this kind of fearless joy in speaking all the time. So because this bodhisattva has cultivated and is to these four fearlessness, fearless eloquences to perfection, to completeness, then he has no fear when meeting any theories, outside theories.
在佛寺的时候，在印度有96种外道，那么很多这个印度的外道呢，其实他们也修行，可是因为修行呢，他虽然很精进，也修苦恨，但是因为他那个教理呢，不究竟，所以呢，很多人修行呢，就变成修来修去，最后也不能证果，也不能这种了生脱死，把这个生死给了了，脱离六道轮回。那主要就是因为他的教理不究竟。可是当时呢，很多印度的外道呢，他们也学习很多这种像辩论的法门，所以在印度是很盛行辩论的。那么佛寺的时候，外道这么多，当然呢，就很多人呢会来跟佛辩论或是挑战。其中有一个很有名的例子，就是舍利弗尊者的那个舅舅。舍利弗尊者舅舅本来就很会辩论，他以前呢在家的时候啊，就喜欢跟他姐姐舍利弗的母亲来辩论。那时候呢，舍利弗的母亲还没有生舍利弗，每次呢辩论，这个舍利弗的姐姐啊，这个舍利弗的舅舅呢都赢了，那么他的母亲呢都辩输给他舅舅。可是自从呢他的母亲怀孕了，就是有这个舍利弗尊者以后，每次一辩论呢，那舍利弗的舅舅就输了，所以他的舅舅很紧张啊，说：“哇，我以前辩论都赢了，现在我每次辩论，我姐姐就胜过我了。”那表示他这种怀孕呢，这个胎呢，这个胎儿呢，一定是一个很有智慧的孩子。那么如果他以后出生了，我这个做舅舅的来跟我这个外甥呢来辩论，如果辩输了，那不是很没面子吗？所以他就有一点害怕了，他就想说，我应该呢现在要开始呢要 要再学这个辩论了，那再去深造。因此呢，这个他的舅舅就到南印度去，那去跟很多这种外道的这种论师就来学习辩论，学了十几年。你看他在学习过程中啊，这个非常的精进的。他因为呢读了很多这种外道的论点，怎么辩论，或是呢实际的辩论，所以他每天很忙，忙到呢连这个啊剪手指甲的这种时间都没有。因此呢，他这个手指甲呢就很长很长啊，就是那个指甲很长以后甚至会卷曲了。那么因此有些人就称他叫做 长爪梵志。这个梵志呢，就是他指甲是很长的，梵呢就是一种清净恨，那智就是呢修清净恨的一个修行人。虽然他修行这种 法门呢，但是因为还不是像佛法这么究竟，不过呢也是在修行。那所以有人呢就称他叫长爪梵志。那因为他这用功这么精进呢，等到他觉得他学成了，过了十几年他就回来了。回来以后他就问他的姐姐说，哎，我的外甥在哪里啊？我现在呢想找他来辩论了。这个他的姐姐说，哦，你的这个外甥呢已经跟这个佛出家了。因为舍利弗尊者呢他很小，这个大概十二岁左右呢就随佛出家，所以呢这个时候呢他的舅舅呢很不服气了。他的舅舅叫摩诃屈希罗，他非常的不服气，就说呢，我的舅舅一定我的这个外甥呢一定是一个非常有智慧的这种孩子啊，那么要做他师父，如果呢这个不是有特殊的能力的人呢是没有资格的，那这个佛呢他怎么有这个资格来做我这个外孙的这个外甥的这个师父呢？因此呢他非常不服气，要去找佛呢把他的外甥给要回来。因此呢他就到佛的精舍，那么到精舍以后呢，他就跟这个释迦牟尼佛说了，说呢把外甥还给我。那么佛就说呢，你的外甥是自愿跟我出家的，又不是我强迫来出家。那么这个他的摩诃屈希罗呢就说，这样好了，我来跟你辩论，那么如果我辩赢了，你就把我的外甥呢还给我，我把他带回家去，那就不要再做你的弟子了。但是如果我辩输了，我就把我的头呢给你他非常有把握的，就是一定会赢了，那输了就自杀了那佛就说我们要辩论呢就要立一个宗这个所谓立一个宗，就是好像你要辩论的时候就有一个主题嘛辩论的题目是什么。那所以佛就问摩诃屈希罗尊者说，你要以什么为宗呢？那个摩诃屈希罗呢就很有自信的说，我立以一切不受为宗，就是呢我立的这个宗教一切都不受，你不管呢你讲什么那我都不接受，我不接受呢你就拿我没办法。所以呢他自信呢能够立于不败之地的，这个反正佛再会辩论呢，佛讲的再有道理，那因为他立的宗呢是一切都不受一切的你说的任何这种道理我都不接受，那当然就赢了。可是呢佛呢就反问他一句，就是说你立以一切不受为宗，但是现在我问你，你受不受你自己立的这个宗？这个摩诃屈希罗一听呢糟糕，自己输掉了。为什么呢？如果他说那我不接受我立的这个宗，他这个宗就立不住了，他怎么还可以立出这样的一个宗呢？所以他知道自己败了，就光佛这样一句话呢就把他呢给打败了。他呢这下子呢这个无地自容，就想想我刚刚跟佛呢约定了打赌，我呢这个输了要把头割下来的，这下子呢一句话就被打败了。所以呢他想想呢就赶快跑了，跑到半路上呢又想，不对了，我是一个大丈夫啊，我怎么这个言而无信呢，讲的呢没有信用的话。所以呢他又回去了，回去以后他说跟佛呢说，你借我一把刀。这个佛就说，你要一把刀干什么呢？他说呢，我跟你约好了，我要把头给你，所以现在我要把我的头割下来就是我要履行我的诺言。 佛就说在我的佛法中呢是慈悲的、你不需要呢那个把头呢割下来，你只要这个跟着我来出家好好修行呢那就好了，这个那你这个头呢还是可以好好来修行啊，留下来吧。这个摩诃居士的尊者呢一听原来佛是这么慈悲的，所以呢就跟佛出家了。一出家以后呢他很快也是证大罗汉果，所以也是一个佛的弟子。事实上在所有的佛的弟子当中呢，你看有1250个常随众，几乎大部分的弟子啊、也可以讲几乎快100%都是外道来的，就是他们以前呢都曾经跟着这个外道的师父去修行，只是因为修行到一个时间呢都不能突破，最后呢就跟着佛来出家。那么所以这些佛的弟子呢最后都成为大阿罗汉了，就是已经证到四果的阿罗汉，那都已经了生脱死了，就是表示呢他们这一生完了呢就都不受生死轮回啊，就是可以出离三界。那么所以呢佛呢在当时呢就是因为具足了四无碍辩，所以呢他摄受了很多这些外道来作为他的弟子，并不是说他呢自己呢啊这个打着旗子啊到处说我现在成佛啦，我要广收弟子，而是外道呢因为呢来找佛啊来辩论，或是因为佛的德恨摄受了他，所以呢就成为佛的弟子。那么你就可以知道佛当时呢跟任何一个人在辩论的时候他是无所畏惧的，如果他心里有一点畏惧，那我相信呢佛呢一定辩不过他们。
So in the Buddha's time, when he taught, there were 96, you could say, externalist ways, you know, these teachings that teach outside the nature. And so he, and all these other ways of teaching, these kind of ways of teaching outside the nature, because they weren't based on one's inherent awakened nature, they did not lead to any awakening, any, you could say, for instance, awakening as an arhat, or any of this, the different stages of arhatship. They had no way to be able to transcend birth and death and leave samsara. So although they had all this kind of logic, debate, which was very popular in India at the time when the Buddha was in the world, they didn't have the way out to be able to to leave the cycle of birth and death. So one story that illustrates this was actually the story about Shariputra's uncle. Now, Shariputra's uncle really liked to debate. He would go and debate with his sister, his elder sister, who was going to be Shariputra's mother. And her name was Shari, right? Shari and then Putra means son. So Shari would debate with her brother, or Shariputra's uncle would debate with his sister, and he would always win, and win in those debates. However, when Shariputra's mother became pregnant with him, all of a sudden she became the victor in the debates. And then Shariputra's uncle started having a bit of a concern, a bit of worry. He thought, wow, this baby must be really smart. If my sister who's always lost to me in the debate before now is beating me, I bet that baby is the one that's influencing it. And he must be really, really wise. He must have a lot of intelligence. So as an uncle, it really would be not look good if I lost to my nephew. So I'm going to go off and learn debate so that I can, when he grows up, I won't lose face to him. I will be able to out-debate him. So off he went down to southern India to study debate and study logic and study all these various externalist philosophies. And so he studied for over 10 years and he studied really, really vigorously. He was very diligent and persistent to such a point that he earned the reputation of the name of called the long-nailed ascetic, the one who cultivated like this, cultivated and had very long nails, because he didn't even have time during his studies to cut his nails. He was just studying all the time, trying to learn how to debate so that he can be his nephew. So at the same time, he still was a cultivator, so people consider him a cultivator. And then one day, after a certain amount of time, he thought, okay, I'm ready. He's getting back to his home and saw his sister and said, okay, where's my nephew? I wanted to bait him. And his sister said, well, you missed your opportunity. Your nephew's already became a monk under the Buddha. And this really upset him. His name was Mahakashtila. And so Mahakashtila thought, what does the Buddha have that he can be my nephew's teacher? Only somebody who's really, really well qualified can be my nephew's teacher. He doesn't have the qualifications. He can't be my nephew's teacher. So he became very angry and wanted to find the Buddha to get back his nephew. And so he went off to find the Buddha and went to the place where the Buddha was staying and saw Shakyamuni Buddha and demanded back his nephew. He said, give me back my nephew. You can't take him away. And Shakyamuni Buddha said, well, I didn't take your nephew away. He himself wanted to become a monk. I did not force him. He said, well, let me tell you something. I'm going to debate with you, and if I win, then you give me back my nephew. If you win, then I will give you my head. So the Buddha said, okay. And the Buddha said, okay, so then first, before we start a debate, you have to set up a principle. So in the debates, you have to kind of set up your basic principle whereby you're debating from. So he asked, the Buddha asked Mahakashtila, so what principle do you establish? Mahakashtila then said, okay, I established a principle of accepting nothing. And so this principle he thought was really skillful, because if that was his principle, then whatever the Buddha said, he would not accept. He would reject. And by rejecting everything the Buddha said, he would win the debate. And then that would be it. He'd bring his nephew back home. So then the Buddha looked at him and said, okay, well, I'll ask you a question. Do you accept your own principle? And now this really, caused some problems, because if he was going to accept his own principle, if he was going to accept his own principle, he would have accepted nothing. So, or if he didn't accept his principle, then he couldn't even have his principle to stand on. So he was in a kind of a quagmire. He had in a kind of a conflict. So he thought, what do I do now? If I lose the debate, I was going to give up my head. So he thought, okay. He became really afraid and ran away. And as he was running away, after some time, he thought to himself, what? Why am I running away? You know, I'm a man. I'm somebody who has, I should have some strength, some internal integrity. I should keep my promises. I can't just run away and be this kind of fearful person. And so he went back to the Buddha and said, okay, give me a knife. And the Buddha said, why do you want me to give you a knife? He said, because I promised I'd give you my head, so I'm going to cut it off and give it to you. And the Buddha said, well, you know, you don't have to do that. You don't have to cut off your head if you want to, since you lost the debate. Instead, how about you keep your head, and how about you cultivate? You can become a monk and you can cultivate the way. And so Mahakashtila thought about it and said, wow, the Buddha is really compassionate. He allows me to become a monk and cultivate. And so he chose the option and became a monk and cultivated vigorously and actually became an arhat and awakened to the way. And so in the Buddha's disciples, he had 1,250 monks who constantly followed him. They were, his constant companions and following him around. And many of them actually came from other religious groups, other externalist teachings. And they came to the Buddha after they cultivated their ways and didn't come to any success. They might have cultivated to a certain amount of vigorous practice, but they were unable to really leave the cycle of birth and death. And so when they became a monk under the Buddha, they cultivated and were able to realize fourth-stage arhatship and become great, great arhats who have ended the cycle of birth and death. And so the Buddha, you could say, had the four fearless eloquences. And because he had the four fearless eloquences, anybody who came to debate with him, he was able to out-debate them or gather them in. He knew exactly what to say. So the Buddha didn't go about advertising himself and say, you know, I am this great Buddha, I've awakened, and try to gather disciples that way. No, he was just fearless. Whenever anybody came to question him and debate with him, the Buddha was fearless. He knew exactly what to say, so they naturally he naturally gained a following.
在中国呢，也有一个很有名的公案，就是佛教跟道教之间呢有一段斗法。那么是在中国呢东汉汉明帝的时候，那个时候呢，汉明帝在晚上做梦，他梦见呢有这个金人，就是全身呢都是金色的啊这样的一个人，所以他就问他的太史，那太史告诉说呢这个。这个金人就是西方的圣人就是佛，因此呢，汉明帝就派了他的大臣叫蔡英，带了十八个人呢到印度希望呢能够去把这个佛法呢请到中国来。那这十八个人呢，他们在半路上就在葱岭的地方呢，就遇到了那个两个从印度来的这种比丘。其实呢，他们都是正果的阿罗汉了。一个叫色摩腾，一个叫竺法兰，这两个尊者呢，他们呢其实就准备要到中国来弘扬佛法。那个时候呢，佛法其实还没有传到中国。那这十八个人遇到两个尊者就很欢喜啊，他们 不需要再到印度去了，那就呢把这两个尊者所带的这个经典，用一匹白马呢驮着这些经典，就到中国的这个。洛阳，因为那时候汉朝东汉的首都在洛阳，到这个洛阳以后呢，汉明帝很欢喜，那么就请这两个尊者呢来翻译佛经，所以在中国第一部翻译的佛经就是四十二章经，就是这个时候出来的。那因为呢汉明帝呢他遇到了佛法心里的非常欢喜，对两位尊者呢很恭敬，就常常供养他们。可是其实在这个汉朝的时候呢，那个在中国来讲，那个道教呢也是很兴盛的。中国呢有五岳就是东岳、这个西岳、南岳、北岳、中岳这五座呢，这个很有名的山呢。那山上呢也住了很多修道的人，都是呢因为佛法还没到中国来嘛，所以呢在很多山上都住了这个道家的道士，他们也在修行。那个时候呢，因为皇帝呢对这个两位尊者非常恭敬，非常礼遇，所以呢，这个道士当时呢，他们就生了嫉妒心了。他们觉得说，这个是一种怎么讲，是邪教吧因为他们从来没有见过佛教，那么这种邪教的异端呢传到中国来，中国的皇帝呢居然被迷惑了，因此呢，他们也跟这个皇帝呢来谏言，就是说呢，这个教呢这种真理呢只有一个，那么现在呢这个皇上呢你也相信了这个佛教了，那事实上呢我们中国自从以前呢到现在，我们这个道教呢都是大家所共同相信的，我们也有这种道教的经典，现在呢他们两位来中国也在翻译这个佛教的经典，那我们呢是不是可以来比较一下，就是斗斗法，看呢这个真正的这个法呢，哪一个才是真的？这个皇帝呢就问这些道士说：“那你们要怎么比呢？怎么斗啊？”那个这些道士就说：“我们呢可以呢来建造一个这种法台就是呢一个高台，然后呢把这个佛教的经典还有道教的经典呢一起呢。”就放到火里面来烧，那么如果呢这个经典呢被烧了，那表示呢他这个法就是假的，如果呢这个烧就是没有办法被烧掉的，那这个一定是真的，那这个道士一定很有自信的，他大概也试过，所以呢觉得呢他们道教的这个经典呢应该是不会被火烧掉的，那皇帝也答应了，就要让他们来这个比试。事实上这一段以前我曾经在那个在中国的汉书里面确实有记载，就是在佛道有一点在斗法，那所以呢等到真正斗法的时候呢那时候文武大臣或是 皇帝都来观看了，包括呢洛阳城里头的百姓也来看这个佛道在斗法，那么一斗法呢 本来其实在中国以前有些道士呢，他们也有一些修行的，因为在一般来讲我们讲有五种神通，这五种神通呢是啊，这个通外道的，就是如果你依据佛法来修行呢，也会有六种神通，可是这六种神通里头有五种神通呢啊，其他的外道他们修行也可以得到的啊，所以有些道士呢他们也有一些神通。那当时呢有些道士啊，他们也可以啊，像在天 就是呢他们在空中走路啊，可以在水上走路啊，可以啊遁到地里面去，就是也可以显现一些神通，那来表现他们的修行。那所以呢很多道士呢就开始呢啊，就显现他们种种修行的成果。那么这个时候呢，他们用这个啊道教的经典跟佛教的经典就放到火里面去烧，结果呢一烧，那个道教的经典呢就被烧光了，烧成灰了。但是那个佛经呢没有被烧，不但没有被烧呢，它这个佛经呢啊还在虚空中现出了色力，而且呢放光。因此呢这两位尊者啊，他们因为都证果了，证这个阿罗汉果，所以呢两位尊者他们就永生到虚空中，现了十八变了。这个阿罗汉呢有十八变啊，他可以在空中走路啊，行住坐卧都很自在的。因此呢他们就现出一种神变。其实现神变呢是一般平常不现的，就是真正有必要他们才会现出这些神通。所以因为这样子呢，当时很多人呢、啊、包括这个斗法完了以后呢，但很明显的是那个佛教呢就胜了。因此呢有三百多个这个道士就剃度了，他们出家呢来 做这个出家人了。那么在道士呢为首的有一个叫楚善信呢，因为他失败了，所以呢当场他很生气啊，就活活呢就气死了。
So in China, there's also an instance of this kind of, you could say, competition, this kind of dharma debate, this dharma competition. So in the early days, before Buddhism came to China, China was very Taoist. Taoism is a religion that's been in China for a long time. And one day during the Han Dynasty, there was the emperor had a dream of a golden person and asked his one of the officials, what would this dream meant? And the official said, well, that's because in India, in the West, there's a sage, and that's what you're dreaming of, this golden person. So the king was very interested and said, okay, he sent off one of his other officials, Cai Ying, to go to invite people to come who would represent this gold person he had in his dream. So he sent Cai Ying out with 18 people. And on the road to India, this group of 18 people met two monks, these two Indian bhikshus. And both of these Indian bhikshus were arhats. And so, of course, seeing these two monks, they were very happy because now they don't have to actually go all the way to India now to find somebody to bring back. So now they can just go back directly. So they brought back these two monks and brought them to Luoyang on a white and put all the sutras they had the scriptures on a white horse. And so at that time the capital of the dynasty was in Luoyang, and the king was very respectful to these two monks and gave them the resources to translate the sutras. So this is where the 42 section sutra first was brought to China. You know, this was the early text that was first translated to China in Luoyang. So the king, of course, was very happy and would constantly make offerings to these two monks and take care of them, and was very respectful. And so at the time, not only was Buddhism coming to China, but Taoism was also something that was very popular, was very, you could say, prosperous. There were five different places in the east, in the north, in the west, in the south, in the center, and all on the different mountains. There were many Taoist cultivators who practiced various, you could say, ascetic practices or Taoist practices and meditation. And so they really had some skill as well. And but when they saw that the king had really become Buddhist and had faith in Buddhism and was making offerings to these two monks, they became somewhat jealous. They thought, this is not right. This religion from outside, they thought was maybe like a cult, a deviant religion. And they thought, this is not a Chinese religion. You know, the king has become confused, has become misguided and lost. We need to go, you know, set him straight to make sure he knows what to believe in. So they went to the Buddha, or they went to the king, and they said to him, well, you're studying something, this other religion that's outside from China, outside of China, but something that we've studied and the Chinese people have believed in for a long time is Taoism. What we should have is a competition, a kind of a spiritual Dharma competition. And the king said, well, what kind of competition are you going to have? He said, well, what we're going to do is we're going to put all our scriptures on a very high platform, and then we'll set fire to them. And we'll see which sutras burn, which scriptures burn. If the Taoist, whatever scripture burns, that scripture is false. Whatever scripture doesn't burn, that scripture is true. So I'm sure these Taoists had a lot of faith in their scripture. They probably tried it before and they knew their scriptures wouldn't burn. So they were proposing this competition to the king. And so I think I actually looked into the various, some historical texts in China, and there was actually some mention of this. Anyways, many people came to watch this this instance where the Taoists and the Buddhists were having this competition. And so these people, ministers come, probably 300 some people. And so in addition, these Taoists also had some spiritual powers. In Buddhism, we talk about there's six spiritual powers, but five of the spiritual powers are shared by other external path as well, in terms of what they do, in terms of their cultivation. They can also develop five other spiritual powers, such as being able to fly in the sky, walk on water, read people's minds, do various things that are on these various spiritual powers. And so so the externalists can also have these powers. So these Taoists manifested all their spiritual powers to kind of show off. But when they actually set fire to the scriptures, what happened? Well, all the Taoist scriptures burned, and they burned to ash and disappeared. But the Buddhist sutras, they actually not only didn't burn, they were an empty space and emitted sharira and emitted light. They were clearly not being burned. And the arhats, these two bhikshus, also had spiritual abilities. So they leapt into the air and manifested the 18 spiritual abilities of an arhat. And this is, for instance, being able to go into the air, walk on water, in all various positions, lying down, sitting, etc. They were very at ease. They had all various spiritual powers. So they would manifest all these abilities. Of course, in Buddhism, the manifestation of spiritual abilities is not something we usually do. It's something that is but only when there's a particular situation that really calls for it. So the arhats were manifesting their spiritual abilities. And all those who were the audience, all the onlookers, saw this situation, and they had faith in the Dharma. And 300 plus Taoists at the time, at that point, decided to become Buddhist monks. So they left home and became Buddhist monks. And the leader of the Taoists, however, I don't think I got his name, but he was extremely angry, so angry that he died.
So, 我们依照佛法来修行，其实呢，在佛教讲到很多这种畏惧啊，比如说我们人呢，有这种死的畏惧，或是呢，遇到恐惧的事情，你就有畏惧，或是呢，在很多人面前呢，也会有这种叫做大众威德畏，很多人面前很多人就害怕了，不敢讲话，那也是一种畏惧，或是呢，有时候跟人家讲话，那就讲不出来了，那也是一种畏惧，所以当我们 依照佛法修行呢，就是我们心中为什么没有恐惧呢？因为我们心中有光明的，这个光明就是我们啊一些不好的事情诸恶莫作，所有的恶事不做了，那你这种心里头呢光明坦荡，这个时候呢就开始没有畏惧了。可是我们过去做过很多啊错误的事情，但是因为明白佛法，我们就会忏悔，忏悔以后呢，我们的这种心呢就开始又开始清净了。这个忏悔就像我们的衣服，我们穿了它脏了，你不需要把衣服丢掉的，你不需要再换件新衣服，你只要把衣服呢拿去洗一洗，它又干净了，等到你在穿的时候还是很舒服的。所以忏悔就是有这样的一个作用。那么当我们心呢逐渐光明清净以后呢，心中就没有恐惧了。没有恐惧呢，那当然你不管啊遇到任何事情的时候，甚至这里呢这个菩萨说呢，他不惧议论了，等到有这种邪说异端或是有人要来跟他辩论的时候，那菩萨呢都能够泰然处之，一点呢都没有恐惧。入诸智地，那么这个时候菩萨呢，因为他顺佛菩提，他随顺这个佛的这个菩提来修行的，所以呢他入了，能够证入到这个诸佛的智地啊，就是佛的智慧了。佛有什么样的智慧，这个菩萨呢一点一滴开始证得了。因为有智慧，所以他做的事情呢啊，就离这个佛道就越来越近了。这个时候就离二乘道，二乘就是声闻缘觉。二乘的这个道理呢不是不好，它叫做方便。因为呢这个佛呢要教化众生的时候呢，他如果没有方便，很多人呢一下子就不能接受，因为他不相信，或是呢根本听不懂。就像你啊要来教导一个小孩子，如果你不给他一些小学的课程，你马上呢给他大学的课程，他呢当然学不来了，这个不是一般人都能够学习的。所以呢这个佛也是一样，他有这种啊全巧方便的智慧。他一成佛以后呢，他知道那个时候的人根气不好，你跟他讲这种大乘的法门或是成佛的法门，他不但听不懂，而且呢还要毁谤。那佛呢知道如果众生呢啊听不懂来毁谤这个佛法，就要堕落。因此呢佛那时候呢就不说了，他就开始讲这种二乘法，就是讲声闻法、缘觉法，也就是讲四圣谛法、苦集灭道，还有讲这个缘觉法、十二因缘法。那么因为呢讲这个法，这个法呢事实上它最基本就是呢它修行就很容易入手，而且呢很快就可以证果。因此呢这个佛弟子呢很多人很快呢，他们因为学习啊根据佛的教导来修学呢这种二乘法，就证了阿罗汉果或是证了这个必支佛果。那么其实证阿罗汉果或是必支佛果都可以呢了生脱死了，就不在三界里头继续轮回。因此呢他们就以为呢这是一个究竟的道理。可是呢佛呢到法华会上的时候，就跟这些二乘人说呢，以前我教导你们的都不是一个究竟的，那是一个方便啊，就是方便的法门。所以现在呢你们的修行呢其实呢还没有到终点，你们只是在半路上。半路上有一个化成啊，这个化成是我变化出来的，就是让你们啊，先证得阿罗汉果啊，先证得啊必支佛果，所以现在呢，你们至少你们在六道里头这种生死的苦都了了。但是呢，我的目的就是要每个众生都成佛，因此呢，你们继续要发菩提心，回小向大，继续向这个佛道迈进。所以在《法华经》上就讲到说呢，第二品就是讲这个叫方便品，那表示佛呢以前他讲的声闻法、缘觉法，还有甚至是菩萨法，都不是一个最究竟的法，他只是呢一个佛的方便，先呢用一种比较粗浅的道理来教导这个佛弟子，等到他们根气成熟了，就是有这个程度的时候，那佛呢就用大乘的法门或是呢这个成佛的法门来教导他们。所以呢这个时候呢所有的那些佛弟子啊，就是大阿罗汉，他们就开始呢啊回小向大，就是呢这个 回小乘的向着大乘的，就是呢他们继续呢发菩提心、来修行这种菩萨道，最后呢他们也愿意呢像佛一样成佛来广度众生，所以这就是叫离二乘道。那么基本上并不是说二乘道不好，二乘道也是修行的必经的过程。像现在我们看到这些十地品里头每一地的菩萨，他们在修行过程中其实有些法门呢没有离开这种二乘的法门。那可是菩萨在修行的时候，他不执着这是二乘能修的法门，他是用这种大乘的菩提心来修这个法门。所以这种二乘的法门是修行的一种基础，这个基础呢你打好了以后，那么你当然你要修行更高深的法门就不会有问题了。可是二乘人因为他执着说我修这个法门已经圆满了就近了，所以就不需要修行，因此呢他们在佛教来讲叫做自了汉，就是呢把自己给了了，生死了了，他就不发菩提心来教化众生。所以呢这个就是所谓的二乘道。
So again, in Buddhism, we talk about people have various fears. We fear death. We fear a lot of things in life. For instance, people have a fear of speaking in front of audiences. They have stage fright. And when people go on stage, they kind of have nothing to say. They don't know what to say. However, what can we do so we don't really have any fear? One is to... because we don't have enough brightness, enough radiance inside. And how do we cultivate this radiance? This radiance comes from doing no evil deeds, not doing anything bad. So we don't feel like we have to hide anything. Everything can be out in the open. We have this kind of bright light that shines out. We don't have this kind of selfish, hiding, concealing mind. But of course, before we study the Dharma, we make lots of mistakes. We've done things that we wish we've never done, we're ashamed of. What can we do about this? Well, the Buddha gives us the process of repenting. We can repent of the mistakes we've done in the past and then go towards the good, to renew ourselves and do the good deeds. So it's like we have clothing that gets dirty. And once it's dirty, what do? Do we just throw it away and get a new set? Well, instead, what we can do is actually wash it. So this is like the repentance, is we're just washing our dirt, our laundry. And after we wash it, then we can wear it again, and it's very comfortable. The clothing is clean and wearable, no problem. So we're very happy. So that's the process that we want to use to be able to purify and clean out our mistakes. And when we do that, then we can cultivate to a place that we don't have any fear, because we don't have anything that we want to hide. Everything can be out in the open. And so this is like the Bodhisattva, why he's this stage, has no fear. The next one, which is that the Bodhisattva enters the ground of all wisdom. Here is talking about the Buddha's wisdom. And he's cultivated this drip by drip, drop by drop, step by step, bit by bit. He is able to develop in this direction and develop the Buddha's profound omniscience, this kind of all wisdom. And so as he's cultivating this wisdom, he's drawing nearer and nearer to the Buddha's path. And so he leaves behind and he separates from the path of the two vehicles. The two vehicles refer to the vehicle of arhatship or the sound hearer disciples. And the other vehicle is that of the Pracheka Buddhas. We can also translate as the solitary enlightened ones or the ones who are the silent Buddhas. They don't speak. They wake up, but they don't teach. And so it's not to say that the two vehicle teachings are bad. No, they're useful, but that they're expedient. The Buddha taught them because at the time he was teaching, those living beings did not have the affinities and the good roots to be able to learn the Mahayana Dharmas, to learn the Great Vehicle Teachings. And so he taught these initial teachings as an expedient. It's like if you have an elementary school kid, you wouldn't teach him college-level material to the elementary school kid because he wouldn't understand any of it. The Buddha was worried because but the Buddha didn't teach it because he saw that if living beings learned it, and they might not, one, not understand it, the other is that they might not believe it, and worse is if they learned it and didn't believe it or understand it, then they slander it. they would speak ill about it, and that would create a lot of bad karma. So the Buddha didn't teach until much later about the Mahayana Dharmas. He first taught the two vehicle teachings, and so those are, for instance, the Four Noble Truths, the 12 conditioned, the 12 links of dependent origination. And so he taught these things, and the arhats and the monks became arhats and Pratyeka Buddhas. And later, he continued to teach, for instance, the Lotus Sutra. He taught them that this wasn't the end goal. There's a greater purpose I want to teach you. That is, I wish for all of you become Buddhas, to wake up to the wisdom of all Buddhas. And this two vehicles, these teachings that I just taught you, they were just expedients. These are not to be too attached to. They're not the end point. And so he gave an analogy that his teachings, these expedients, is just like him creating a, we literally translate this, transformation city. It's almost like a mirage, you know, it's a place that you create a mirage. And he says, I created this so that on the path you could have something to shoot for, but when you get there, it's not something to attach to. It's the arhatship, being a bodhisattva, I mean, being a Pratyeka Buddha, there are not any places to attach to. This is not the ultimate dharma. So in fact, the bodhisattvas included. The arhatship, Pratyeka Buddhas, bodhisattvas, all of these are not the ultimate aim. What I hope for all of you is that you become a Buddha, that you can develop your aspiration for Buddhahood and cultivate the way so that you ultimately become a Buddha. And it's not to say that the teachings for the Arhat and the Pratyeka Buddhas are not useful. In fact, the dharmas of these dharmas are in this text. For instance, in the sixth ground bodhisattva is cultivating the 12 links of dependent origination. However, the mind that he's using to cultivate with is not the mind that's attaching to those as the endpoint that wants to become an arhat. Instead, the bodhisattva has the aspiration for Buddhahood, and he cultivates these very same dharmas, but with a different mindset, with a different aspiration. So therefore, he lays a foundation, but in a very different way. He doesn't get stuck at the level of the two vehicles. For the two vehicles, they just cultivate these dharmas, and then they think, well, I'm done. I finished my work. I can end birth and death and leave samsara. But then they don't have this Bodhi mind.
这个二圣道就是代表小乘，那么当然，那个菩萨乘呢，或是佛乘，就是代表大乘。在印度呢，也有两个兄弟，一个呢学大乘法，一个学小乘法。学大乘的是哥哥，那个叫做无着菩萨；学小乘的是弟弟，叫天亲菩萨。 那么两个人呢学了以后呢，这个弟弟呢就不认同哥哥的。那哥哥呢不是不认同弟弟，哥哥是觉得呢弟弟呢有点可怜的，他还没有明白这个大乘的佛法。大乘的佛法这么好，但是呢他的弟弟这么聪明，居然呢没有来学习这个大乘法。他完全相信这个小乘法，不但相信这个小乘法呢，同时他呢。 觉得这个大乘法呢是不真实的，因此呢，他写了很多论，他很会写书的，写这个论啊，就是像论文一样，就来呢驳斥或是毁谤这个大乘佛法。那么他的哥哥呢，就怕他堕落，因此呢，就要用一个方便的法来度他的弟弟。所以有一天呢，他的哥哥就写了一封信，跟他说呢，我现在生病了，已经快死了。 那我在我死之前呢，我最希望的就是能够再见到你一面。所以呢，他弟弟呢就念在兄弟之情呢，就去呢见他哥哥。见了他哥哥呢，他哥哥又跟他讲说呢，我现在一辈子呢都研究这个大乘的佛法，可是现在我病呢，我呢不能在我这个死之前呢再来读这个大乘经典，你能不能呢？ 帮我读一遍这个《华严经》啊，你读一遍给我听，那我死了呢，这个死了呢，大概就是没有什么遗憾了。这个弟弟一想呢，这些大乘经典呢，本来都是他 啊、最不喜欢的、最反对的，甚至呢来写论、来反驳的。那现在他哥哥呢，因为都快死了，这个能不能啊，就是说他能够不为他的哥哥做一点事吗？所以就很勉强的就答应他哥哥，那就来读这个华严经。读华严经呢，因为他的弟弟太聪明了，他一读华严经呢，马上就明白原来这个华严经的道理这么好，这么究竟，比这个小乘经典超出了、这个百千万亿倍了，不能相比了。那他越读呢 越欢喜，也越读越害怕。为什么呢？欢喜就是说原来的这个、大乘的经典这个义理是这么好的，那现在他遇上了。那么害怕是他以前呢、写那么多的论啊，或是很多演讲来毁谤大乘佛法，现在他知道错了。所以等到他读完这个华严经呢，他就跟他哥哥讲说呢、你给我一把刀子。他哥哥说，你要刀子干什么呢？他说，以前呢我常常、那个毁谤大乘经典，造了很多恶业，现在我读华严经了，我知道我错了，这个华严经这么好，是最究竟的道理，那我这个错呢很难弥补了，我用我的舌头呢、讲了那么多毁谤大乘经典的这种话呢，那现在我要用刀子呢把我的这个舌头呢给割掉、那我要来忏悔。他的哥哥说，你何必这样子呢？你以前用你的舌头呢来毁谤大乘经典，那你现在可以保留你的舌头啊，你用你的舌头继续来赞叹大乘经典，那不就好了吗？就可以将功补过。他的弟弟一听，这有道理啊，所以呢也就没有割自己的舌头。那他开始呢就研究这个大乘经典，等到大乘经典他研究了，他有这个心得了以后呢，他就造了很多这个论。这个造论呢，他现在呢不是来毁谤大乘了、是来赞叹大乘的这种、佛法，同时呢把这个大乘经典呢也做了很多注解。像在这个我们现在研究的十地品，其实呢他有另外啊，这个北就是从这个十地品呢、也讲到十地品的，有一个叫做十地论。这个十地论呢，就是就像讲专门讲怎么修行这种十地法门的这种啊经典。那么这个天亲菩萨呢，就造了一部十地论啊，就专门呢来研究这个十地的法门。等到他这个论呢造成了成完成以后呢，这个时候呢大地六变震动，那个地都动了。哇，那个整个国家呢很多人都感受到，怎么突然之间呢我们这种地呢都动了啊，这个在佛教叫做啊六变震动。那这个国王也知道了，因为这个国王呢他也学过佛法，他就知道说，如果呢有人证了阿罗汉果了，那这个大地呢会六变震动。因此呢他就啊来找到底为什么这个地呢震动了。那最后就找到这个、天亲菩萨。那么他就问这个天亲菩萨说，是不是你证了阿罗汉果啊，为什么我的国家这个地都动了。天亲菩萨就跟国王讲说，哦，我没有证过，但是呢因为我造了一部论，这个论呢今天完成了，所以呢、就感得这个大地六变震动。这个论呢就是十地论，也就是像现在我们研究的这个十地品、这些法门。因此呢这个就是呢有些呢、以前很多人他修行了二乘道，最后呢他也回小向大了，就是他知道原来的二乘道不是不好，只是不究竟，因此呢继续呢来研究大乘的佛法，这就是离二乘道。
So next one is talking about separating from the path of the two vehicles, or we're continuing on that one. So the two vehicles sometimes also is called the small vehicles. The small vehicle because they're out to only rescue themselves and they don't end up rescuing all living beings. The other path vehicle, which is sometimes called the great vehicle, is the vehicle of the Buddha and the Bodhisattvas. And so this one, they make vows to rescue all living beings. Now back in India, there were two brothers. One brother was named Vasubandhu Bodhisattva, the other one's Asanga Bodhisattva. Vasubandhu Bodhisattva was a younger brother, and he had deep faith in the small vehicle teachings. And his brother, older brother, studied the Great Vehicle Teachings. Now, Vasubandhu Bodhisattva was very, very, you could say, obstinate. He thought, you know, I don't think that the Mahayana teachings are such and such, such and such. And he didn't believe in them at all. In fact, he was such to the point that he would actually write treatises criticizing and slandering the Mahayana teachings and praising the small vehicle. And so his older brother, Asanga Bodhisattva, saw the situation and felt a certain degree of pity and concern for his younger brother, and thought of a skillful way to be able to, you say, cross over his younger brother, to have him see the value in the Great Vehicle Teachings. So what did he do? He sent a letter to his younger brother and said, you know, I'm very sick. You know, I don't know if it might be the end of my life, and I hope I could see you at this time. So Vasubandhu Bodhisattva thought, okay, well, of course, because they're brothers, they have the affections of siblings. So he came to just see his older brother and to see him. And his older brother said, you know, my whole life I've studied the Great Vehicle Teachings, but now I'm so ill, I can't study it at all. I wonder, can you do me just one favor? The favor is, would you be able to recite the Avatamsaka Sutra for me? That would make my life final and complete. So Vasubandhu Bodhisattva, of course, thought, well, you know, my whole life I've not studied the Mahayana teachings. I always thought they were bad. And now I have to read it from my older brother. But because this is my older brother's last request, I think I should follow it, that I'll do that. So he started reading the Avatamsaka Sutra. And as he read it, he became more and more happy. But at the time, he also became more and more afraid. Why did he become more happy? Because he thought, wow, these Great Vehicle Teachings are so wonderful. They're so profound. They go to the depths of things. But at the same time, he had a lot of fear in his heart. And this was because he also thought, you know, my entire time before, I've been criticizing and slandering the Mahayana teachings. This is really, really bad karma. I'm sure to bear the heavy retribution for what I've done. And so Vasubandhu Bodhisattva then told his brother, give me a knife. His brother said, why? He says, I'm going to cut out my tongue. He said, why are you going to cut out your tongue? He said, because I've used this tongue to slander the Mahayana teachings. Now, his brother said, don't do that. You don't have to cut out your tongue to make up for that. Why don't you take your tongue and your skills and eloquence, and rather than slandering the Great Vehicle Teachings, instead praise them and explain them? Wouldn't that be a lot better? Vasubandhu Bodhisattva thought about that and agreed, okay, I will study and teach the Great Vehicle Teachings. And so he actually did quite a lot of work, because he was quite a prolific writer and very intelligent. And so he was composed various commentaries. And one of these was a commentary on the Ten Grounds that we're studying right now. And when he wrote that, at one point when he finished, the entire ground shook. There was a small earthquake. And the king at the time, out of some Buddhist background, knew when this happens, sometimes it refers to somebody who wakes up, who becomes an arhat, and the ground shakes in this way. And so he went and found Vasubandhu Bodhisattva and asked him, so do you realize arhatship? Is that why the ground is shaking? Vasubandhu Bodhisattva denied it and said, no, that's not the case. The reason that the earth is shaking is because I just finished this commentary on the Ten Grounds of the Bodhisattva, and this is why the earth is shaking. So in terms of the two vehicle teachings, this Bodhisattva does not follow them, instead turns to the Great Vehicle. This is not to say that the two vehicle teachings are something that's bad and should not be followed. In fact, they're actually very good. But the only thing is that they're not ultimate. That in Buddhism, the ultimate goal isn't just to end up in the two vehicles, but to really become a Buddha.
我想今晚我们华严经就研究到这里，因为明天呢就是夏令时间了，那表示呢今天晚上大家要少睡一个钟头，所以我们有四个人准备回去万佛城，那3点半要起床。因此呢，如果最后大家有问题可以问，那如果没有，我们就到这里结束了。
So we'll finish the sutra lecture tonight, because tomorrow is going to be daylight savings, which means that everybody will lose an hour of sleep. and so they wake up a little bit earlier. And four of the people in the community here is going to go up to the sitting thousand Buddhas tonight. And so we have to wake up for a morning ceremony. It's at 3:30, so it's very early. So if people have questions, you can ask at this point. Otherwise, we'll end the lecture. So anybody have any questions? How about? Okay, so no questions. Then we will end the sutra lecture now. What you will find is the dedication of merit sheet on your, that was right behind the Dharma request sheet. Oh, you do have a question.
Oh, 好。你可以翻译。
OK， 它是我们现场的广播。
我先讲一下，就是在3月15号星期天，有一个教授叫王才贵，我相信很多人听过他的名字。这个王才贵教授，他在台湾20几年前，他开始推行儿童读经教育。那他。就是很发心的，所以现在这个儿童读经教育非常的成功，不管是在台湾、中国、马来西亚、新加坡、香港，或是他以后也到美国来，在北美洲呢，他也推广这个读经教育。那么1998年8月，这个王才贵教授曾经到忘我圣城，在我们的佛殿做的演讲，同时他也曾经在法大跟很多老师啊、家长举行了座谈。那1998年到现在是7年了，然后今年呢，王才贵教授呢，就是应邀，又有人邀请他到北美洲来巡回演讲，那他就在加州有1-2天的空档，所以他就想到他曾经到过忘我圣城，因此他就跟安排的人提议说他要到在就地重游，又到忘我圣城，所以就跟我们联络，因此就安排了这个王教授在就3月15号。很快就到了，礼拜天的晚上7:30到9点，在忘我城的佛殿要做一场演讲。那因为是公开的，而且佛殿有很多人不是只听懂这个中文，所以我们会也会做翻译。这个翻译的人呢是培德中学的学生他可以帮忙做翻译。那个王才贵教授他主要要讲的就是说，除了读经以外，那在这种在美国北美洲呢这个英文的环境当中，如何让孩子呢能够继续学习这种中国儒家的传统经典，或是呢除了英文之外，同时也把中文学好，那或是呢这个学习了这些中国儒家的这种经典道理以后，它的这种价值到底在哪里。那么王教授呢他会做很精辟的这个演讲，因为演讲呢本来是比较长的，可是因为我们要做翻译，所以他只能有大概45分钟，所以他可能只能很精要的来做演讲。那同时第二天呢，在3月16号，这个王教授呢也会到培德这个我们圣城的中小学就是玉良小学培德中学去参观访问。那目前我知道是早上他会到我们南校我有一个班也是小学生，也会跟这个王教授见面。同时呢在中午的时候，王教授12点钟他会在女校跟女校的老师还有可能有学生，他们也会有一些座谈。那么到1点钟的时候王教授呢会到道元堂跟南校初高中的学生也会有演讲跟座谈，这是目前的一个情形。那至于呢会不会有这个转播，我在想我们考虑的就是也可以考虑做网络转播，或是把它录影下来，我相信是很值得的。因为王教授的演讲呢是世界性的，他到现在已经到全世界去做这样的一个演讲，很受欢迎。如果我们可以把他的这个演讲能够传播到世界各地，那也是一个很好，是把它录影呢留下来，以后呢任何人要看都可以的。
So there was a question online about a visiting professor named Wang Caigui. Wang Caigui. So Professor Wang is a very well-known, renowned professor who really, you could say, promoted the, I don't know how to translate it, Dujingban is a kind of studying the sutras, not exactly sutras, reading the classics, that's right, the classics, reading the classics as a way of study, as an educational system for young people. So he really promoted this, and it actually took root in various countries, in Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, various places, and in America as well. And he really encouraged that children be able to study the classics. So he's been doing this for 17 years, and he came to CDDB in 1998 and shared his ideas. And now, many years later, he happens to also come back to America and be in this area. And so he told the people that he would be interested in visiting the City of 10,000 Buddhas again, because he visited a long time ago, and see what's happening. And so we had this opportunity to invite him to also speak at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. So on March 15th, from 7:30 to 9 p.m., he will be giving a talk in the Buddha Hall. And this is a Sunday. And so it should be very good, because he's actually a very experienced public speaker, and his topic is something that's very dear to his heart. And we will have a translation into English by one of the students of the boys' school who's very good at translation. And so so it should be a very good talk. His topic will be around the reading the classics, Confucianism, the value of Confucianism, how to kids, especially in this here in America, are able to learn Chinese and Chinese culture and the values of that. And so this talk is for about 45 minutes, because we also have to do the translation, which is another 45 minutes. Now somebody, and then the next day, he'll be also coming to the boys' school and the girls' school to talk with the students on March 16th. In the morning, he'll talk with the elementary school kids or the kids in the boys' school, and then in the afternoon, he'll go to the girls' school and then come back to the boys' school about 1 o'clock to talk with the older students. And so he's somebody with a lot of experience. Now, in terms of this lecture being broadcasted online, I think it's a good idea. I don't know if there's any plans for it right now, but we should definitely videotape it, because it's a really important, it's a very valuable resource. He is somebody who's well known internationally. And so I'm sure if we were able to broadcast this online, a lot of people would be interested, and it would be reach out to an international audience. Okay. 你要讲吗，金博士？你讲讲。 Okay. If we have another microphone, maybe 金博士 can speak. The okay. what we also have here in Berkeley on the same day, but in the afternoons. So if you finished a session here, you can go up to CDV. But what we have is a March 14th and March 15th, we have an Amitabha weekend, an Amitabha weekend. And so people who would like to recite the Buddha's name for a weekend, we'll be starting on Saturday with the 8 precepts at 8 a.m. to 9 a.m., followed by a day of recitation. And then we'll have the sutra lecture as well on that kind of spirit. And then on the Sunday, again, we'll start at 8 o'clock and finish about 5 o'clock. So if we finish about 5 o'clock here, you can still drive up to CDB by 7 probably and make it in time for the 7:30 lecture by this well-known professor. So that's what's happening on next weekend, so coming up very quickly. So if you'd like to register, we have registration forms in the back, I think on the counter. Also, the for those online, you can register at the Berkeley Monastery website. There should be a registration form there. So we please ask everybody to register so we can get the right headcount for food and logistics. So it'd be really appreciated. Last time we had it was quite popular, so I'm sure this time will be quite full as well, so we need to prepare. Okay, so we also, if people would like to write Paiways, Jing Forsher was encouraging, because especially, you know, that this time's still the end of the kind of the period of the new year, the Lunar New Year, is that it's a good time to remember those, like our ancestors and our relatives, to be able to transfer merit to them. So if people would like, they can write up 2 pai ways each, maximum. You can write one for either a long life or a rebirth, or 2 rebirth, 2 long life plaques. And there's not a cost for them, people are welcome to write them. But you need to make sure you have to write them here in the monastery. You come, there's a sheet that we're writing down the names for the plaques. Hi, Ma. And I don't think there's anything else particularly. So next week we'll have a lot of activities starting on the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, all day. So people are welcome to come. Okay. So what we have is our dedication of merit is on the back of our Dharma request sheet. So I invite you to pull it out, and from spending a day or an evening here in the monastery learning the Dharma, there's a lot of goodness. And so the idea is that we can take that goodness and transfer it to all living beings, give it out. And so the dedication merit serves that purpose. Okay. So I invite you to put your palms together. May every living being, our minds as one and radiant with light, share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness luminous and bright. If people hear and see how hands and hearts can find in giving unity, may their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward. May all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light break the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise. Okay, we can all stand up and bow to the Buddhas. Please get up slowly if your legs are asleep.